in 2019, we've tried to remember what we were doing in 1979, you know, 40 years later. And Mark Bedford said, we rehearsed at the Roundhouse and we did the two-tone tour. And then suddenly, like, our management booked 3 days at the Roundhouse. And then we thought, oh, you know what? You know, we did the Electric Ballroom 40 years ago. So we did the Electric Ballroom and we charged the same £2.50 or something. I think the booking fee was more than the ticket this time, you know.
Hey, you! Don't watch that! Watch this!
Years of chaos culminating in a couple of gigs at the Roundhouse and the Electric Ballroom. It was a kind of welcome home or an invitation from our fans to perform at their party. It was nerve-wracking due to the preparations, but it was worth every minute of it.
Being in Madness has been an incredible experience, of course, you know. I mean, 40 years. I mean, we wouldn't have thought it was going to last 4 weeks. You know, we got a gig and we thought, well, that's great. You know, we've got a residency every Friday night. A few girls turn up. We're earning £5 each. And we made a record, and we said, well, no one can take that away. You know, no one would have imagined that 40 years later we'd still be doing this. So it's been my everything, really. You know, it's been my life, for sure. You know, it's been very... I don't know what we would have done. You know, I've got no idea what I would have done without the band.
I think where the band and all the band members, the areas that they came from, played a big part in not only the sound of the band, but also the people we are, I think, because we were surrounded by a lot of really great people who are into lots and lots of different things. And I think that that really influenced us as people, and it really, obviously, then it kicked into the music as well.
When we were growing up, it was quite interesting, the amount of times when Woody was somewhere that I'd been. Our paths had crossed mysteriously. I mean, Mark lived not that far away, but Lee and Mike lived very near me. Highgate Road, so that was our kind of area, you know, Camden Town, Kentish Town.
Everything that I tell you, girl, every word that you hear, well, every little clear. There are no lies to deceive you. I love you too much for that. And every word that I say is true. You can't believe me, I'm that. Because my friends tell me jealous eyes. Now I'm getting my goodbyes. No, 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 no. Well, life without my dear, with dull as dull as can be. I ask you now, why not take me now? Don't leave me in misery. Hey! Well, if you take it all they say, I guess I'll be on my way. Please, my darling, it's not true. I don't know, no girl could say. No, Sue's a name I have not heard. I lost my girl from that one word. Will she come back? I just don't know. And I'm taking a heavy blow. Oh, got myself together,
no, 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 no.
In this cold weather,
no, no, no.
Christmas comes but once a year. It's a time of love and
The earliest memory I've got of being on stage was when I was about 8 or 9. Yeah, sat cross-legged at the front playing these coconuts. It was to replicate a cantering horse. Just sort of locking eyes with my teacher, Miss Mills, for support. But I did feel very calm playing that clippity-clop, clippity-clop, clippity-clop.
My mates who were into music, we would go and see bands, and my mates who were not into music, they wouldn't sort of come along. So we started sort of whittling down a sort of group of friends who were very much into music, I guess.
The desire to be in a band started very early, and I grew up in an area that had loads of live music, like the Roundhouse was just down the road from me. You did aspire to being on stage, and you saw bands like Thin Lizzy. I did like the rock music, I have to say.
Ian Dury's band were Kilburn and High Roads before they were the Blockheads. We went to see them and it's like amazing. And I'd say that was kind of a bit of a template, you know, for us, because they're the sax, they're the piano, and their songs varied between sort of reggae-ish to sort of slightly rock.
It was mainly me and Chris who were turning up and pushing things forwards. And slowly we started just getting a little bit better, a little bit better, and then we got together, we did a first gig.
We played in people's houses, and Mark, we played at his school.
We got a lot of good reaction from people around us, friends and stuff, and they would turn up, and their interest was sort of spurring us on, I guess, as well.
It just seamlessly mutated from shoplifting and train hopping with me mates to taking our driving tests and going out with girls and playing along the music that we loved.
We discovered there was another band called The Invaders, so we changed our name to Madness, which was a very important moment.
I knew I had the band, and the band are like a family, but all the music was new. Being in a gang was new. I was never into the fashion, never into their music. I was a fish out of water, and I was a scared, frightened kid.
No, I was very nervous as the singer of the band. The first concerts, I was literally petrified, as I mean, you know, couldn't move. And couldn't look at the audience, couldn't look at the band. I was terrified, yeah. But the big revelation was seeing the special at a pub called The Hope and Anchor in Islington, and then suddenly I saw this band who were leaping around like lunatics, with Neville blowing holes out of the ceiling with a starting pistol, you know, and that was a kind of like, wow. And I think all of us got a boot up the arse.
I've probably got it there, don't you?
If anyone complains, give them the £2.50 back, right?
There is such confusion in my mind. To play your illusion was so unkind. No, I didn't know. Change again, or stay the bleeding sane. How I met you, I'll never know. But I thought I know you, you're telling me to go. You said you'd be back, you told me wait here just in case. That you never arrive, and I'm waiting outside your place. Yeah.
the early stuff, the ska and reggae, I mean, that music was always in the firmament of the pop charts in England. Ska music had been a big part of certainly London culture from when I was a kid. The carnival, you'd always hear reggae records coming out of house parties. But then another turning point was I went to the Roxy in 1977, which was the punk club. And because there were so few punk records, Don Letts, who was the DJ, would play reggae records in between. So you had this really great combination.
Well, I'm standing here in the rain. Maybe the weather will change again.
Initially, you start off covering songs to put into the set because they're sort of crowd pleasers in a way, and it's maybe something that the crowd, the audience probably don't know you, but they might know that song. Covers also good musically because they help you figure out how other people write songs, but we would reggae-fire them, as we'd say, and we might do a reggae version of things. But Tears of a Clown at that time in 1979 was a weird hybrid song which was a bit reggae-ish but a bit like the original. So it was very interesting to come back and do it again, and I think we did it in a straight away this time at the shows at the Electric Ballroom.
When there's no one around. Now if I appear to be carefree, it's only to camouflage my sadness. In order to shield my pride, I try to cover my heart with a show of gladness. But don't let this show convince you that I've been happy since you decided to go. I put on a show. Ooh, oh, there's some sad friends now I'm so mad. But ain't too much sadder than the tears of a clown when there's no one around. Ah! Just like Patty on, she did. I tried to keep my sadness in, smiling in the public eye.
My first public performance was probably in a school assembly when I had a band with my brother, and we played some covers of, you know, like Jumping Jack Flash, Long Train Running, All Right Now by Free, you know, that kind of stuff.
We started writing songs quite quickly, so pretty soon we went from being a covers band to a pretty original with a few covers here and there. And I think it might have been Mistakes was one of the first songs, which was the B-side of one of our early singles, One Step Beyond.
The days when the B-side was a fucking B-side, you know what I mean?
Mistakes, I've made a few, and then again, too many to mention.
Not everybody was writing songs at the time, but, you know, when you got seven people and everybody did become, to my mind anyway, reasonably good, if not great, songwriters. And so there was a lot of us doing it. So obviously, you know, many hands make light work.
Some genius said, if you get a little chimpanzees, they'll write Shakespeare. If you put us in a room for a couple of weeks, we'd write a load of songs.
I guess for us, it's much more interesting to write your own songs than just play covers.
No! It's not so easy to find out later about the necessary knowledge for survival. You think you know enough to get you through life, but find out too late of chances pass by. An early start is not so important, but timing is most essential.
too. Opportunity gone is gone forever, and you will find out to your cost. A better use can be made of your time. Yeah.
A whirlwind. I mean, at the start of 1979, you're painting bed knobs and broomsticks, and you're laying turf, and you're working on the council, and the next minute you're flying up the charts. I mean, absolutely crazy.
There I was, and all my dreams come true programs, old Grey Whistle Test, Top of the Pops. Wow, I still felt like a scared kid.
1979. It was a crazy, epochal year, you know, and that was the year when the whole band coalesced, and obviously we saw the specials and Two Tones started, and suddenly what was, you know, us just having something to do so that we could get off the streets robbing phone boxes was becoming something that could actually project us out of the situation we were in.
1979 started in a quite an odd way, because I think we played a gig to about three people. But the winter before, you know, in 78, we'd done a lot of work. We'd really got a set of songs together. And they were the songs that were to be the One Step Beyond album. But everything just, the pace quickened all the way through 1979. And there was the meeting with the specials at the Hope and Anchor, which we'd found someone sort of kindred spirit and who seemed to be a bit more advanced, had a bit more connection to record companies, and were going to try and include us. The specials signed to Two Tone, and Jerry Dammer said, "You come and make a record for Two Tone." So it had gone from a standing start, gone to sort of like 100 miles an hour really, really quickly.
I remember in reading in the music papers, a lot of bands were talking about you've got to earn your dues, you know, these old rock bands, and they've been like touring the country for 20 years before they had any success. but we were luckily didn't have to go through that process, and it all happened pretty quick, yeah, which was good, you know, fine by us, yeah. You know, I mean, you, if you don't need to earn your dues, why hang around earning your dues? Well, just get on with it.
We weren't really ready to make a record, but we made a few demos, and The Prince, of course, which was the first single, did sound all right. I mean, much to the amazement of all of us. And we weren't really ready, but it just suddenly took off like a rocket, you know, that year.
Hello, boys. I haven't seen you for a long time. I remember you were upstairs right at the Top of the Pops. I remember your first single, Prince.
This is Jerry Danvers, everyone. Fucking 1979. We started Two Tone Records. He said, you sound like a bunch of chancers, but he did it. And we recorded this next tune on Two Tone Records, and God bless Jerry Danvers. Hang on.
Still got all his hair. How annoying.
Take that wig off. No, I'm talking to Jerry. I'm talking to Jerry. Not you, he's fun.
An earthquake is erupting, about nothing, I'm in the street. A ghost dance is preparing, you gotta help us with your feet. Cause if you're not in the mood to dance, we'll step back from this summer seat. This man up in uptown Jamaica, but we promise you the treat. And what fuss about me over with your focus dancing, shoving me off my feet. Even if I kept on running, I'd never get to I'm in the street. So I said there's nothing left to say for the man who set the beat. And I leave it up to you out there to get him back on his feet. Yeah. 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 Oh, bust above me up a wicked bogus dance and shovel me up my feet. Even if I kept on running, I never get to the other end of the street.
No! We've got fucking E17 here.
Hello?
When we made our first album, we had 10 days to record it, so, you know, it was pretty rapid. But we'd been playing together for 6-8 months. We'd done a lot of gigs, so we were kind of up and running, you know, and all the songs were written. But I really loved it, yeah, and I remember I stayed there pretty much every day. I was really fascinated by the process.
Well, you walk on here up sharp at 6:30. A cold shower down to breakfast. Can't have you looking dirty.
Up until then, we'd only ever heard ourselves on these, you know, one mic hanging off the ceiling, recordings onto a cassette. So when we went in the studio, the sound was, you know, it was like completely different ballpark. You know, you're all fudging away on your instruments, and then you're hearing this bloody, like, really great recording that sounds like a proper record.
Lights out. Lights out.
Oh, that was the bed and breakfast, man.
Oh, there's a man I know. At least I used to years ago. I didn't really mind. He used to come in all the time. He had to be fed. I had to give him a bed. He used to get on my sofa. They used to call him a loafer. Well, I heard he's changed a lot since then. But some of his ways, he just can't fit.
No!
Unmendable! Unmendable ways. Come on! We told the other day that he'd have had to pay. He never left. That side, the only ever had.
Whoa!
done that in my life. It's never worked. I feel like Sting now.
First time round, and you fuck up, you're only 26. Oh, in nappies! In nappies!
Whoa! 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 Stand going home, everybody sing. Whoa! Odeo song, a company routine. Whoa! Odeo women, odeo young men. Whoa! Try to change places, then back again. Old men in the morning, young men at night. Breakfast full of wisdom until you hit the light. No better drinks, hitch up your skirt.
I do sort of remember the Electric Ballroom. I remember a lot of sort of skinny types turning up and quite a, you know, atmosphere, yeah.
In 79, I think we played there twice. Both times, we'd had to come on during the support band set because they stopped playing because there were fights in the audience and try and wrestle back a bit of control.
I remember playing there, you'd look out at the balcony, there'd be some big punch-up going along, and also it was like the year after, we were massive in Europe, you know, and we'd go and we'd meet these lovely journalists, you know, in Spain, France, and they go, oh, I saw you at your ballroom, I got mugged. You know, it's like a badge of honour, they'd all got mugged or somebody had hit them or, you know.
Breakfast full of wisdom until you hit the line, hit the line.
The nice thing about revisiting the Electric Ballroom is seeing all the happy, smiley, lovely people at our gigs these days. So a lot's changed. It's much nicer to play a madness gig now because you've got a lot of love in the room.
You said you're leaving, well, that's okay. You said you've had enough, what can I say? I suppose I'll be sad for a week or two, but in the end, it's the same for me and you. We'll both be sorry for that vote. You said you've had enough, well that's okay. You said you moved on, what can I say? I suppose we'll be sad for a week or two, but in the end it's the same for me and you. We'll both be sorry for and for me and you. You must stop doing this, you've got to change, cause you hold all the cards, you've got the range. Every time I go away, I get to think, 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 think. You said.
I had a funny relationship with music, yeah, because my mum was a singer, a good jazz singer. But I think, like most kids I met whose parents were making music, it was embarrassing, you know, no matter how good she was, think, oh no, mum's gonna start singing in the fucking pub, you know, I just wanna hide. So I was always surrounded by music, and so it must have permeated me some way or another. But at school, I wasn't musical. I mean, I was in the school orchestra for one day because the double bass player had dropped out, and I was the only kid big enough to hold the double bass. So the next thing, I'm performing Wagner's Ring Cycle in front of 300 parents with absolutely no idea what I was doing.
Hello. I am the governor of the Dublin Castle.
You are? And this is my girl. Can I have a gig now?
Come and see me later.
My girl was the sort of like turning point. And Jerry Demmer said he'd done about a bunch of chances. It could be a band. And Barzo used to sing My Girl, but I'm not going to inflict that on you right now. My girl's mad at me. didn't want to see the film tonight, and I found it hard to say. She thought I'd had enough of her. Why can't she see? She's lovely to me, but I like to stay in and watch TV. Times for fucking about being stupid, yeah. But we kept making hits and kept making really funny videos, so they kept having to have us back and they really hated us. I remember there was this producer, he said, "You are an embarrassment to yourselves, me and the BBC." It was the arrogance of youth, you know, we were having a lot of fun in it, you know what I mean? Even though it may have seemed a little bit threatening to some people.
My vantage point at the back, I can see everything that's going on. I can see all the little games that the band play. I can see the way they communicate with each other. But more importantly than anything else, I can see the audience. I can see their reaction and their faces and singing along with the songs. I feel a real connection as well, because everyone's dancing in time with what I'm playing.
That's brilliant.
Someone is losing their brain. Madness! Madness, they probably madness.
It's the biggest venue in Camden Town, an iconic place, which we used to go to, some of us, in the mid-70s. They used
used to have a psychedelic thing on a Sunday called UFO, and it was all Pink Floyd types and all that. And you could get in for nothing, so we'd just go in there and just have a laugh at all the hippies. But then, well, yeah, later on, we were rehearsing to go on tour with the Specials for the Two Tone Tour in the Roundhouse. So it's great to be able to go there and perform in such an important venue of our lives and our career. I mean, I saw a million bands there. I saw The Clash, all the punk bands, and then I saw my wife's band, Deaf School, and that's the first time I saw my wife. So the Roundhouse has a lot of happy memories for me.
Came in the wrong place. Came much too early. You started. He started singing it, and we'd already finished.
Well,
his work.
I stopped after the count. So, I think
something went wrong. I'm saying something went wrong. We were playing the wrong part in the wrong place. I don't know what you're just playing the drums. Do it again. It was a mistake. But anyway, let's do it.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Let's do it again.
Great thing about the Roundhouse gigs was that we decided that we'd support ourselves.
Being our 40th anniversary, it seemed quite fitting to replicate the back music room at the Dublin Castle at the Roundhouse. Owners Allo and Peggy gave us our first residency there. They had a decent mix of young and old and socialising drinkers and live music lovers. 3, 2, 1, Madness really learnt their trade in the Dublin Castle amongst friends and family and basically laid their musical building blocks. Collecting this 70p admission on the door of the Dublin Castle was my wife Tokes, and you couldn't get past her unless you wanted a clump.
Camden Town was a sort of epicentre of our operations. You know, it was a very exciting place. The market was not what it is today. It was full of bohemians and hippies and second-hand record shops and second-hand clothes shops. There were all sorts of independent record labels starting up. So it was where we hung around, you know, where we would literally walk around of an evening, going into pubs saying, could we get a gig? You know, and often we couldn't, but then occasionally we would. And obviously, in the end, we got a residency at the Dublin Castle. And that was really the turning point, because it meant we could get a bit of a following, and that turned into a queue outside, which turned into a scene. And then record companies start getting interested. So that was really where it began.
69. 79.
Went out on the two-tone tour with Specials as selector, and there was a great camaraderie among all of us. You know, we learned a lot, I guess, about playing live, you know, having a show and the audience participation, and, you know, we always had a bit of theatrics going on, which was always very enjoyable for us, at the very least. Hopefully for the audience as well.
There's a club down the road full of people waiting to see us.
Until the next lot's on stage, you ain't going in.
There's one thing I never get bored of, and that's playing with the band. After all these years, I still absolutely love playing live. Before we even get on stage, there's a buzz, there's a confidence, there's a sense of magic.
Hey, you! Don't watch that! Watch this! One step beyond! We'll be right back.
Let's have some what? I know, saxophone.
If you ask me to describe what Madness songwriting is about, I would say it's probably a quite happy up sort of song with actually quite a dark underbelly. They're quite sly in that respect because they're songs that on the surface might sound happy and up, but actually if you think about them a little bit, there's kind of quite a darkness to them underneath.
Telling you,
Check with Road and Parliament Hill. In the laundrette with time to kill. Selling England by the pound. Coming out of the underground. Stevie Wonder in the Rainbow Finsbury Park. Through the exit went the final few. Zoe Bowie came to Roxy too. David is Essex, his Mercedes in the dark. Friday night, Bazooka Joe was doing alright. Hunky Dory and the coming of glam, a 69 shirt and a caftan. Falling down to the sound. Guess what? Prince Buster and and the dark side of the moon. Hampstead Heath, Frank Kitty's town. Moon in June, killing me softly with your song. The best years of Elton John. Ivory Corner in 73. Before we was we. To that fucking sound. Grandchild 72. Ian Dury and Wilco too. Pans Moods, Huffity Pop. Larry Siegfried, It Must Be Love. And Elvis returns with This Year's Model. Got a job driving, what's a doddle? I thought that I might just start a band with a couple of mates. Wouldn't that be just grand?
I really do love being in this band with these people, although at times they do fuck me off. I'm sure I'd fuck them off, you know, with the way we are, the way we've been, the way we were. But I wouldn't change it for the world, no. I'm just so proud that we're still breathing. You just breathe, it's pretty good for you.
The band is my dysfunction family, my journey, my roller coaster, and I love them all, every one of them.
Yeah, there was a definite attraction because we were all from disparate backgrounds. You know, we were some strange surrogate dysfunctional family. You know, for all the better and the worse, you know, for all the arguing and the fighting and everything, but a lot of love, you know, we grew up together. We learned together, you know, through the process of making music.
We spent so much time together, so it is a family in a way, because we've had to rely on one another down the years like a family. We've had arguments like a family. We've had fantastic times like a family. And I think another great skill of us actually going on for so long is that we also know where to avoid one another as well.
I tell you, I didn't do it, cause I wasn't there. And don't blame me, it just is a fact. You listen to their side, I listen to mine. Come think of a story, show your family some time. Now pass the blame and don't blame me. Just close your eyes and count to three.
One, two, three.
And I'll be gone and you forget. The broken wind our team is set. No. It wasn't me either, I'm just his mate. He told me to stand here and watch the guy. I have a wife and three kids, you know. I tell you I'm straight, at least I think so. Cause I'm as honest as the day is long. The longer the daylight, the less I do wrong. Now pass the blame and don't blame me. Just
close your eyes and count to three if you can.
One, two, three.
And I'll be gone and you forget. The broken window TV set. Now get off your horse and drink your fucking milk.
Some musicians don't want to play their old stuff. They want to keep doing new stuff. And I think that's a little bit of a misunderstanding about how things work, because even if you've played that song 7,000 times, you know, it's not the same moment. You're somewhere else, there's a different crowd.
I mean, at one point I was going through this thing where I kept worrying about, were we good, were we not good, was it great, was it shit? And my wife said to me, for fuck's sake, you're in a band, you're supposed to be playing music, you know, what are you talking about, all this other stuff, you know? And when you get into the music, it's, you know, music is great, you know? Why is it still going after all these years, you know?
Morning, miss, can I help you, son? 60 today, ha! Enough for fun. I'm a big boy now, or so they say, so if you serve, I'll be a moped. Box of balloons. With the feather I touch, a pack of party poppers, and a pop in the night. A teapot has spray plastic with Miss Kay on the curtain, just walked in. Welcome to the house of fun. Now I've got my babe. Welcome to the house of fun. Oh, welcome to the lion's den. Temptation done his way. Welcome to the house of. No, 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 miss, you have misunderstood. 60 big boy, a full point in my manhood. I'm up to date, gonna date to date, so if you serve, I'll be on my way. Welcome to the house of fun, now I've come away. Welcome to the lion's den, temptation's on his way. Welcome to the house of. I'm sorry, sir, we don't stop party gimmicks in this shop. Try the house of fun, it's quicker if you like. This is a fucking chemist.
Night jump shop!
Party hats, simple enough there. We'll comprehend, is that me understand? Do you hear a pack of party hats with the colour tips? Too late. Google's a gossip, well, 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 well. Hello, Joe, hello, Miss Clay. Happy returns from the day. Welcome to the house of fun. Now I've come on, babe. Welcome to the house of fun. And welcome to the lion's den. Temptations on his way. Welcome to the house of fun. Yeah, 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 welcome to the house of fun. Now I've come on, babe. Welcome to the house of fun. And welcome to the lion's den.
I look back and all the memories I had, all the great moments were when we were really having a laugh, but really sort of delivering on what we do as a band together, you know, like all those moments when it sort of really crystallized what we really did something good. They're great memories.
I watched you grow up only to despise the blessing rise up in a very strange disguise. Cause, well, nothing it seems lasts forever, and people change just like the weather. So for good and sometimes never, I hope things work out for.
quite proud, you know, in the respect of we want to write more songs and we want to push the thing forward, always try and look forward, which has been an interesting thing about doing the Electric Ballroom and the Roundhouse, is that it's been great looking back, but we kind of haven't got too sentimental about it.
NW5.
Naughty boys in nasty schools and masters breaking all the rules. Having fun playing goals, smashing up the window door. Other teachers in the pub, passing round the ready room, trying not to think of when the last of our ring again. Oh, what fun we had, but did it really turn out bad? All I learned in school was how to then not break the rules. And oh, what fun we had, but at the time it seems so bad. Trying different ways to make a difference too. The headmasters had enough to die. All the kids have gone away. What's a fight when next to school? Every turn that is a rule. Since the lone admins is came, same old backside again. All the small and total tales, walking home with squatting stones. Oh, what fun we had, but did it really turn out bad? All I learned in school was how to learn or break the rules. And oh, what fun we had, but at the time it seems so bad. Trying different ways to make it ever to the day.
I've got a lot of memories, you know, same as anybody, you know. So for us, it's a celebration of one's life, I guess, you know. And punters are out there thinking, oh, I was round at my mum's when I heard that. I was doing this. That's when I met my wife. And I'm on the stage thinking, this is when I met my wife. This is when I did that, you know. So we're all sort of brought back to enjoying moments in our life. And music somehow seems to bring them in a good light. I don't know how.
Mr. Pharmacist.
We have been around the block several times. Besides it being a big money spinner or rent payer, it still is enjoyable being involved with a bunch of these chancers. I mean, what an absolute joyous bunch to have worked with and had a whole lot of fun with.
You do get people saying, I was up in the loft, and I found this old Madness record. And, you know, it was my dad's, or in some cases, my granddad's, you know, these days. So you get all these kids that like us, and you think, what else they got to like? You know, you come and see us, you know, some funny songs, you know, maybe some serious ones. You know, we put quite a good show on still. I think everyone would agree. You know, we're very blessed to still be popular, to do arena tours and stuff. Yeah.
The only thing that you can ask for, having gone on for so long, is that if the songs are still relevant to people, and I think when you play live and you get that direct connection with the people singing along and that, then you do realise you've made that connection, and maybe that's all you can ask for, that if the songs have just lasted a long time and they still mean something to someone, then that's, I suppose that's your legacy.
I never thought I'd miss you, or half as much as I do. To take the blues away, but, oh yeah, it must be love, love, love. It must be love, love, love. There's nothing more, nothing less, love's the best. How can it be that we can say so much without words? Well, bless you and bless me, bless the bees and the birds, especially the birds. Got to believe every night, every night.
all you need is love.
Normally finish the show with It Must Be Love, and you just look up and you see that effect that the song's having on people, and they have got their arms around one another, and you just think, well, if there is a moment, if there's just a few minutes of people just really sort of like forgetting about things and being really close together, and you've kind of done your job, really, and if you can affect people like that, then it is very, very worth it, really.
'Cause it's nothing more, nothing less. Love is the best.
You ready? One, two, three. Night boat to Cairo.
Years of chaos.
One bit of advice for Mike Brassen in 79. Don't worry, chill out, you know, it'll be all right.
Strangely enough, after having to listen to what I did back in 1979, I was on the right path. It's okay. I just say, keep doing what you're doing. It will all work out in the end.
I don't know, really. Buy bitcoins, get a songwriting credit for Bed and Breakfast Man. Don't shag that bird in New Zealand, because you're going to regret it. You know, stuff like that.
I don't know what advice I could give, because I just think that, as a person, it's been quite a natural journey through, I think, in a way, where you're just human, you make mistakes, and sometimes you try and learn from them and move on, you know?
What advice would I give myself? Try and look after your teeth, Tomo.
It's impossible to think about what advice you would give to yourself, because you don't know. It's a bit like those sci-fi movies, isn't it? You go back and you turn on the butterfly, and when you come to the future, London's to be demolished. But I mean, the only thing I think about myself, I was just very nervous. You know, I was a nervous person, and I still am quite nervous. But, you know, it'd be a bit difficult to go back and tell myself to be less nervous, because there's nothing that makes you more nervous, is there? And someone telling you to be less nervous. Don't be so nervous!
Nervous in Canada!
Move aside, you dogs. Move aside, you dogs. And dance, Cleopatra, dance. Dance, Cleopatra, dance. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, fucking yes. Just gone noon, a past monsoon on the banks of the river Nile. And here comes the boat on the upper float, whose penguins a toothless smile. And only just one more to this desolate shore, last boat along the river Nile. Doesn't seem to care, no more wind in his hair. He reaches his last half mile. He all snaps in his hand before he reaches dry land. The sound doesn't dampen his smile. Just pokes it with sand. And oh, when his hand, he flows soft down the river Nile. He flows soft down the river Nile. No boat to come on. Dance, Cleopatra, dance. Oh, great Caesar. Oh, great Caesar, he was a right tasty geezer.